keep tweeting at LOL Esports, hashtag UOL win. Or if Rocket can fire back, blast off to victory, hashtag ROC win. At LOL Esports is the place, of course. We're going to find out as we load up onto Summoner's Rift for the second time in this series.
Do they ever blast off to victory? At least in the cartoon.
I've watched enough Pokemon to kind of know that they definitely don't have a good ratio of success.
Yeah.
I don't know if they have a success.
Okay. Because I really hope, you know, they used to fly into the air and then that bing. I hope that bing in the sky is the promotion tournament, because that is not the direction
that
you want to be taking.
That's savage.
Rocket are in damage control mode. And I'm only saying this because we're looking at the teams in Challenger. Like, Schalke look exceptionally strong, but every other team looks beatable. So for Rocket, some of the improvements they made in game one could be enough to save them from even getting there. If they can beat Giants, if they can beat Vitality, if they can maybe bypass Origin as well.
And even Fnatic. Remember, they did have one win against this team.
Yeah,
and
that's
Fnatic
true.
Have honestly been in a pretty big slump themselves.
They have been. I still think Fnatic are good enough to avoid the bottom two spots, despite their troubles. But Rocket right now, a win over Origin would tie them with Giants, and then a win over Giants would give them two series wins and would be enough without some big, big win for Giants happening to escape the relegation promotion tournament.
A lot of possibilities. Hillsang gets a ward clear off early. And the crowd goes wild. Stepping up forward this time, trying to push back this Ashe Zyra bottom lane. Very pokey lane. We've seen since the start of 7.1, in all honesty, it's come right back into the circle.
Yeah, all the way from 2013. It is.
Oh yeah, that was a long, long time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Basically, what put Cloud9 on the map was every game was Ashe Zyra, and everybody else has picked it up in this split, and even in last season as well. So
is that when they were still called Quantic?
No, it was after.
Okay,
it was the summer split that they entered.
Ah.
And they dominated, if you remember.
You know what's back also, by the way? League of Thunderlords.
It is.
For this game, anyways.
We've had a lot of the broadcast crew here in EU trying to make as many weather puns as they can. I say a lot. It's more that Trevor's tried to find a new one every time he's casted. But lots of Thunderlords coming through on this Rift. It's unsurprising when you got champions like Rengar, when you got champions like Malzahar.
Kha'Zix.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of hunt this time around. Blast Cone taken by Maxlore. He moves. Start on his blue. Or rather, move on his blue, rather. Xerxes over at the Raptors. I want to see how these two junglers definitely do in the beginning of this game.
I like that Hawkshot sent out from Kiana level 2. Get a Hawkshot through the jungle. They spotted him out on Raptors. Now you know exactly where Xerxes is. You had a good idea before, but you can track how far through the jungle. They knew he hadn't gone to red yet, and that's the important piece of information that they got. You can see Maxwell's now looking to invade on red.
Maxwell's really low right now. He went in with almost no health, and Otto, it's not enough.
Oh, Betsy couldn't quite get it. Didn't want to flash under tower. He knew Exile had flash available as well. And Betsy showing some dominance in that mid lane.
That was a head scratcher, though, for Exile.
Oh, Maxlow could look to come mid. He's going to finish this red. Flash into jump.
There we go. Jumped on, and it's first blood. Betsy tanking tower shots.
No.
He's going to go down, and Exile gets a return kill.
It should have been so clean. It should have been the one for nothing. And Rocket walk away with everything. Betsy had to get grounded onto Exile so he couldn't flash. That's why Betsy went so far forward. Unfortunately, had to try and flash out, couldn't get there. Was too deep under the turret, and Exile picks up the kill in response. In fact, he couldn't get the grounded. Grounded's yeah. Cassiopeia. Just wanted to stun him.
Feels bad, man. Maxlore looking to do something up top, but there's a Chachi with clutch ward there. Place it down. He knows the bug is coming for him, and he throws a couple of barrels out his way. Maxlore, last time around, he definitely had a pretty impressive performance. And honestly, we kind of didn't expect this, but let's take a look at the replay one more time.
Yeah, so it was Flash Rune Prison, and then Betsy got grounded. That was the way around that that interaction happened. Maxlore picked up the kill, and Betsy's like, that should have been free.
Yep. Just a little unlucky.
Not many opportunities you're going to get to kill Exile this early on and not lose anything for it, and that was another one of them where Rocket couldn't quite take full advantage.
Betsy does have a big farm lead, but going back to earlier point, when I talk about the jungle and how Xerxes kind of came into this having a much more impressive record than Maxlore. Last game, notwithstanding, you can see some of the difference. Not massive, but Exile in the mid, trading with Betsy. It goes Xerxe trying to bump his numbers again.
And a lot of it is about that activity. Of course, this doesn't include game one, but you can see Xerxe first for activity early on. Kills and assists at pre-15. Maxlor was last. Well, if on the next game this graphic was run, Maxlor might not be, because he just got involved early on. So that'll bring up his average. A change in style from Maxlor going mid lane. The opportunity was there. Easy to seize it when you're playing Kha'Zix around a low health target in the mid lane, but well done from Rocket nonetheless.
Yeah, improvements in how they're playing this game out. It may not be enough to net them a win against the Unicorns, but as we keep saying, they've got a lot of weaker opponents coming up next. It's an encouraging sign for this team. Back down to bot we just saw. Samix and Helisang pushing in Yharnam and Wadid. Up in top, it's Chachi doing the same thing to Foxy. Taunt does land though, as the oranges, and he's K.
Yep, he's okay. Down in that bottom lane, we just saw it for a moment. Samix and Helisang have themselves a decent lead in bot lane. Faxi knows he might be about to get ganked, so started recalling, and then comes back to lane. Oh, Faxi, careful.
Oh, Xerxe stopped.
Xerxe had the opportunity once and didn't take it. And he's gonna go on him. Oh, Faxi pushes forward. Goes Xerxe.
Dangerous. There he goes. In he hops. Force the flash.
Yeah, gets the flash. No real response out of Faxi. He thought about recalling earlier, chose not to, and ends up having his flash taken away from him.
It's a pretty big disparity in that mid lane. You saw Betsy just getting a bit of an outplay trade onto Exile, and now Maxlor is wrapping around one more time for round two. After he finishes off these Raptors, he might be interested in going for Exile, who still has his flash, by the way. Betsy's still trading excellently. He's showing some dominance in this mid lane. This is something Rocket need.
Yeah, he is really stamping his authority down. Of course, Betsy has the extra experience from being in lane a little faster, and actually getting that kill is the big part of that. Maxlor's looking to come back towards that mid lane. Exile has just got six, so we'll be safe if the dive comes in, if he can land that ultimate, but obviously has to trade through Betsy's shield first.
It's hard. He's nomming those biscuits, but he's going to have to eat fast. Oh, Maxlor turns right on the petrifying gaze. Hopping, delivering Faxi to try and finish.
Oh,
no, Exile gets the juke. The shields are there.
No.
A cannon barrage, and Chachi gets the kill. Betsy on the chase, but he delivers himself right into the jaws of Xerxe, and he gets hopped on and taken down. Unicorns get a 3-0.
3-0 in what was essentially a 1v3 for the majority of that, until Xerxe comes in, Chachi's ultimate assist. That couldn't have gone much worse for Rocket. That was so, so well played out of the Unicorns. Faxi misses his taunt under the tower, didn't have flash to make sure he can land it, because that's the flash Xerxe got earlier as he ganked him, and Rocket get nothing from that exchange.
Not a single thing, and it's a big gold swing for Unicorns as they find themselves 1.5 up over Rocket. These guys are having some trouble. I liked what they were trying to do, but man, you've got to stick to landing.
It's that execution. I mean, you had Exile on the back foot. He was already a kill down, and or at least had been focused out in that lane, and now he gets an extra kill for himself. Xerxe gets a kill. Chachi picks up assists. Even got the kill from it, I think, of the first one. And now Xerxe wants to look towards that bottom lane. There was no ward to spot him out. Does not have his ultimate available, so can't go fully aggressive. But Rocket, execution really undermining that play.
Mm-hmm. Betsy had been pushing in so effectively in the mid, but he finds himself down. Two deaths, and Exile has two kills picked up as well. Flash has just come back off. Exile doesn't have his, so this could be a window to punish both junglers. Are hovering a little close, but not too far. Just trades from the mid lane for now.
And Faxi leaving the lane. Look at the CS disparity because of it again. Now Unicorns have opened up another one up in the top lane. It's 23 CS lead for now. Maxlor's around mid. Oh, Exile gets good damage down there.
Exhaust in hops Maxlor. Exile just out of range. Xerxe's gonna tag in though, and so is Hillisang. This is what happens when you bring more friends.
Yep. Helisang had already roamed up towards the mid lane, and Unicorns are able to turn it around. You could see on the beginning of that trade, Exile knew that Maxlor was potentially in that bush and actually read that very well. Now Maxlor's hiding around the corner because they know they've seen Helisang with that control ward killing the Rocket ward already.
Okay, so there's been a lot of action in the mid lane and some in the jungle as well. But now that we're past that level 6 mark, we're not yet seeing that party in the bot lane that we were predicting. When does that start to happen?
Okay, so Sand United's coming back up. The problem is, Hyannon and Wadid have been pushed in and lost this matchup for quite some time in the bottom lane. But Maxlore has not been there to punish. It's not quite enough to just bring Shen if GP is there, because GP can either TP in himself or utilize that cannon barrage and even up some of the numbers from afar. So Rocket actually need to kind of 4v2 or 3 this fight, and that's tough to do without Maxlore being able to put pressure on that bottom lane. You can see they've tried to get River Vision control. They had some control in the jungle early on, but that's gone now. There's no way of Rocket actually securing all of that and then making a play from it without taking some risk.
Yeah, it's gonna be tough for these guys. Unicorns are playing for the late game, but they're not looking too shabby in the early. It was a big outplay, and it seems like Rocket have played a much more conservative game since then. A lot of pings for Unicorns, actually, earlier on we saw as they were making moves into the Rocket jungle to just try and tell everyone where they were, trade in the mid, or trade in the top, I should say. Foxy going in on Chachi.
And this is the problem that Rocket have. Although, theoretically, their 1-3-1 is good and would be better than most teams, you're playing Shen into GP. GP will clear the wave and push you in all day, and has the same amount of global presence, and is winning the lane as well.
And he's one item away from a training board.
Yeah, exactly. And then you're playing Ryze into Cassio, and Cassio has more sustained damage, and Widit's taking a lot of damage.
Yeah, Widit is getting some help from Faxi. They did turn on, and Yharnam took out Hillisang. Widit just survived long enough to bring the Shen. Samix finding himself only with Xerxe to help him down bottom, and now Rocket are looking to turn it on.
Yeah, Unicorns trying to make a play utilizing this Malzahar, but couldn't quite get it. What will they lose topside is the question. Faxi's no TP, but will they bring Chachi down?
They are. Chachi spends his teleport right now. He's trying to force them to back off. He's going to cancel it, continuing to push on. But now Rocket, they've redoubled their efforts here. There's no minions just yet, but they're bringing Maxlore. They should be able to secure themselves first brick.
Yeah, it looked like Chachi started that TP to make Rocket second-guess their push and force them to kind of lose more minions. And now Unicorns are going to try and push two towers down at the same time it's taking to take one of the Unicorns, but that is the first tower of the game. Yes, on 7.4, some of the gold was reduced from that, but it's still a worthwhile investment out of Rocket to get that. They do lose top tower in the trade.
So they do have a party in the bottom lane, but it is a smaller one than we maybe could have expected. Shen was the only one that came in there, and Xerxe was a little bit late. Now, Unicorn still trying to find this tower. Xerxe and Hillisang, they're zoning Betsy away. He's still firing down an Exile who takes a couple of tower shots. Xerxe locked up. He's still tanking right now. He's going to have to get out of dodge, taken very low, and they don't finish the tower off.
Unicorns reaching for that mid tower, couldn't get it. And utilize the TP on bot lane already. Couldn't save that tower, so Unicorn's stumbling out a little bit. They've got Trinity Force here on that gangplank, can now clear the waves very effectively. This is the play onto bot side, so they saw Winid recalling on the ward, use the GP ult, and they think, okay, everything is great here, but it's just Hillisang. He doesn't have the damage to kill Widid on his own yet, and it's enough for him to survive through, and Rocket to turn it around.
It's the same thing they were criticizing him on the desk, is Hillisang going in, making the play, but there's no allies around him. It's still the laning phase, or at least it was until then. And yeah, you can't really expect to just be able to finish the kill off, so some questions raised for Unicorns. Nonetheless, they're still in the driver's seat right now and looking to get the final shots off on mid tower.
This is the type of thing that you heard Deficio and Hussein, the coach for Misfits, talking about before game one, which was when you're this far ahead of opponents, you kind of sometimes let it slip a bit. I think Deficio was the one talking about that. Hussein was like shaking his head, thinking he wants clean games, as all coaches would. So you can see where the Unicorns would go, okay, let's just flash on the support and use the ult and try and kill him. But it does give Rocket that little bit of momentum just to start gaining it again, see if they can get back into this game.
Nonetheless, though, Unicorns are pushing pretty hard. Up in the top, it's hard for Foxy to really push back, and you can see not just the farm differential that this GP can bring, and Chachi really just making Foxy have a hard time. Mountain Dragon has not been looked at this time around. But with 14 minutes into the game, it looks like Unicorns might be changing that. There are some deep wards for Rocket behind the jungle, but Vizichachi is keeping Faxi locked up here. Teleport advantage on Rocket's side, but it's very minor.
Faxi gets himself a barrel kill. Chachi, you saw the icon above his head go up, and that means he can now afford his first upgrade. Pretty much unanimously is Death's Daughter, the giant central cannonball that fires. That's on that GP ult. Haven't seen GP every game in a very long time. A lot of nerfs hit GP a while back, reducing the amount of barrels he could stack.
Still plays great in Shen, though.
Yeah, exactly.
You can see the difference.
Still has a lot of damage. Don't forget that one.
Yeah, it's off the chart.
Yep.
Or at the chart.
Close. So close to the perfect line.
Yeah.
It was there. It
Give
was...
me a 9 out of 10. I'll
yeah,
take it.
Yeah, that's fair.
All right, okay, so... cool. Hill's saying he's going to spell shield the roots, but with the Scuttlecrab vision down, Unicorns, they have so much on this side. Rocket have a few wards, but the ones they had behind the pit, they're all expired now. There's no chance to teleport in the back. It's going to be on Foxy to do a Stand United.
Yeah, and... now Max loading for Exile Tombs again.
Exile immediately flashing, but it's followed, and they are out of the range of the Cannon Barrage. Exile getting turned on once again. The Shen's delivered, but Xerxay finishes the kill onto Max Lore, squashing the bug down. Foxy by himself here, and the fight is scattered. Chachi looking to get a kill. He flashes into the brush, and he kills Madid, walking outside of the Stranglethorns. Betsy flashing away as the Nethergrass finishes. Hill is staying on the front line. Samix tanking the Ash Arrow. In comes Yharnam, but is it too late right now? He gets a volley off. Samix ace in the hole. Not enough to finish the kill, as Faxi and Betsy are locked up under tower. Yharnam is isolated. Exile goes in for the killing spree.
Exile is able to just survive long enough through these fights. Unicorns all alive, pushing past the tower. Now Yharnam can't do enough on his own. That's going to be another tower going over to the Unicorns.
And they should be able to get more off of this. They get one. They're going to start continuing the push. And they're on top of Yharnam, who flashes away from Xerxy. Betsy turns around. Exile realizes maybe this isn't such a good idea, but Unicorns are still five strong.
These fights, some of them. Oh, is Chachi and Maxlor going toe-to-toe?
Maxlor's already back up. He tries to get the damage. No isolation for you, and Chachi parlays him down. Maxlor dead twice this fight.
Unicorns are going to back away. They're a little low to continue this fight, even though they've got basically like five kills from that. Chachi just picked himself up another two kills, has a Ghost Blade on top of it. These fights keep starting well for Rocket in the sense that like Maxlor keeps dodging out the Petrifying Gaze, which is great. That's how you want to jump in on
that's
that.
That's how you get the montage, for
sure. That's how you go, okay, we've started this fight good, and then unfortunately can't kill Exile by about 200 damage every time. And that means Exile just runs away, turns the damage back around, and Maxlor dies. You'll see it again. This is the second time this game this has already happened, where Exile, he's looking for the ult. Can he quite get it? Maxlor gets the turn. Beautiful timing on that. Flashes the wall, thinks he's got enough. Stand United's great. Everything's here. Ah, there's Xerxay. Didn't kill him quite fast enough. And then Xerxay takes care of Faxi and the rest of them. And Chachi has way too much damage now with this Trinity Force for Widid to survive through. They get the Nethergrasp onto Betsy. And with the Voidlings kiting back, it stops so much of his damage. He can't queue through them. He can't run. He can't stand and try and fight. Yharnam late into the fight. We didn't see where he started this one off. In Unicorns of Blood, there's still five members strong despite being low on health. It's not enough for Rocket to continue this fight. And eventually we see Maxlor come back in, but end up facing the same fate as he did the first time around.
Yeah, that's a long replay right there. Xerxes even had some time on the Gromp. Rocket just not able to execute in the immediate aftermath, and it's unfortunate that they don't have the power to really burst down any of these Unicorns members, because that really can spell the difference between a won and lost fight.
Maxlor thinking he can get one of these targets, low health targets. Can I get the I mean, he's probably, yeah, he's only level 10, so he couldn't get the reset anyway.
Also, Gromp was assisting Unicorns there. Widid's just running around trying to dodge it. 18 and a half minutes. It's a big lead for Unicorns, 5,000. A dragon went down while all that was happening. Unicorns grabbed themselves the Mountain Drake, and there will be an Infernal up next. Baron will also hit the Rift in a couple of minutes. Xerxay getting stopped up. Oh, Widid has to flash the cannons. He's out of there, but it's close.
Yeah, Widid getting away with his life this time. It was unfortunate. Top lane, they just killed Pexi.
He was such a ninja, you didn't even see it.
I mean, Hillersang, his flash is down, his ult's down, Exile got the kill. I mean, we can CSI that crime scene very effectively. Easy.
No replay required.
Pin it on the first guy you see.
Unicorns, they're moving their way up top. I don't think that's usually how it works, but in this case, I think you're probably right. It's going to be more Unicorns pressure up topside. 20 minutes into the game, they're looking to expand their gold lead. It's already three towers, and they will be able to secure an inner as well, rotating into mid. The wards in tow, they are controlling this game.
Yeah, we did. Trying to just get past that line of traps. That's so frustrating. If you've ever played up against a Caitlyn, or if you're like me and you're a Caitlyn player, it's so great. So this is the engage. There you go. Flash into the Nethergrasp. There's the CCTV footage. We got it.
Alrighty. So, Detective Stress, you were right for everything but one. There were two murderers.
Ah. One was an accomplice.
You only get an assist sometimes. XL up top. He's looking to repeat the crime. Everybody's been dodging the gaze.
He outplayed it without even knowing.
Doesn't matter, though. He's exhausted and locked up by three, and they triple time him. Exile with his fifth kill of the game. Unicorns keep on marching.
I want somebody to interview Faxi, and he's going to tell you, like, yeah, I meant to do that.
Calculated.
I knew he could be there.
Okay. Maxlor has isolated some damage on Chachi. Betsy tags in. Can't finish the job, unfortunately.
Unicorns are doing Baron.
Yes, they are.
They have Mountain Drake. They are able to do this. They have Caitlyn. They have Cassiopeia.
Oh, they canceled the back on the bottom side of Maxlor. Baron easily secured, uncontested. And Maxlor does get a shutdown,
yeah.
But he nearly bought it.
Yeah, how did he actually get the kill on that? We were looking at the Baron, and Maxlor managed to shut down Chachi. Looked like Chachi was still low from that last trade, and Chachi was trying to recall maybe out. Interesting.
Is that your best guess, Detective?
No, because I was looking at the Baron, so I can't put my best guess out.
That's okay. We have our trusty replay observers on that. Samix and Xerxes back on the bottom side to keep pushing. It seems like Rocket have really focused their attention on this bottom, but they gave up the Baron, honestly, without being able to get much for it. Let's take a look again.
Oh, Chachi picked this fight. That's a little silly. I mean, that's actually unlucky. Okay, I can't be too harsh on Chachi. He was fed enough that he thought he could get that and easily walk away. Was not anticipating the flash.
So Maxwell gets something at the end of it all, but Rocket are still very much on the back foot. What we saw out of them in game number one, we saw them trying in game number two, trying to punish mistakes, trying to force engages. The execution just hasn't been there for this team, but maybe it's good enough against some of the weaker LCS squads. We'll see. We're still in this series, though. Unicorns are looking to put a lid on it.
Yeah, Unicorns just established control wards, established another grasp on Betsy, cancel it. Samux now caught.
Yep, and he is taken down. Faxi taunts his way in for the kill, and Unicorns, they're going to scatter out of this jungle.
Cancel the TP again. Now Chachi stays topside, and Rocket come out ahead on that one. They're going to slow some of this push here. Of course, Unicorns, that's a minute of their Baron buff gone.
Overextension from the Unicorns, still making a couple of mistakes. Rocket bite back a little bit. Let's see what they can do as Xerxes turns on to Maxlor Realm Warp. Betsy's around the side looking to wrap around. Let's see if they can get a flank off. But Yharnam is going low. Yharnam is going down. Visit Chachi. Gun to the head of the AD carry. And Exile just dominates what did. And Betsy finds himself alone without allies. Even Hillisang gets a kill. Everybody on Unicorns coming up big.
The team fighting Unicorns remains a strong point for them. They're able to catch out Yharnam again. And we came into this series talking about how much damage Yharnam has been putting up. Not this series. Yharnam has not been able to survive long enough in a lot of these fights to output damage. Either that or he's been there late and ends up getting pushed away from the fight before he can ever get there.
First inhibitor of the game now taken by Unicorns off the back of it all. There's an Infernal coming up soon. That'll be on their shopping list for sure, but Unicorns, they're looking to take a very big victory here. Let's take a look at how Chachi made the big play.
that's difficult to dodge around. When a Gangplank puts two barrels in that small jungle entrance.
I love it. Yharnam stops to kill the barrel. He goes, I got this. And then Chachi just turns on and shoots him in the face.
Yeah. It's like, you ever watch the old Batman cartoons or the 60s version where the Joker's got that like bang gun? And pulls out a second one. And
it does a lot of damage?
Yeah, it's the actual gun that's what does the damage. Nevertheless, Hillisang is looking to lock down another target. He's got that flash. He's got the Nether Grasp. If this was Cluedo, you'd only have to guess where it is that the murder was going to happen.
There's been quite a lot all over the rift. And Unicorns are looking to add a dragon to their bounty. Easy peasy, they've controlled most of the map. Rocket are not going down without a fight, but they are running very, very quickly out of options.
Yeah, right now Betsy's pushing out topside. The best he's going to get right now is a top tower, the outer tower, in exchange for bot inner while they've still got the Baron buff up.
Seen these trades
so
before.
With the inhib down in mid lane as well, the threat of the Unicorns here behind the turret, maybe. I mean, Maxlor's top. This is the same mistake they made in game one. Is Maxlor trying to make a play out on the side lane when they're losing an inhibitor turret in the other lane? this is frustrating to watch because we've got past 25 minutes of Rocket seemingly falling apart.
And Exile seemingly moving ahead. He gets one. Can he get more? He gets taunted up, but the rest of his friends have arrived. They jump on to get another kill. Cannon Barrage. Betsy's fired down. And all of a sudden, the Unicorns decide they want to end this right here, right now. And they'll do it.
Unicorns pushing in. This is going to be the win.
Unicorns coming into today looking for a clean 2-0. They may have stumbled once, may have stumbled twice, but Rocket were not able to do it. They will be blasting off into the sky, and Unicorns take themselves a 2-0 victory. Well, that was abrupt. Managing to take themselves the win as Exile turned up the pressure to 11. Unicorns knew they could finish it off, and even Cheapy's having a laugh at the end of it.
Yeah, I mean, Exile ends this game 8-1-5, and consider that at level 3, he was forced out of lane, killed, but traded it 1-for-1. Effective use of that Cassiopeia into the Ryzen. Unicorns, they get their first win in quite a few weeks.
Yeah. Big story of redemption for them today, even though Rocket may not be expected to put up the most massive of fights. Unicorns, it had been some time. They'd have trouble at IEM, only being able to beat Kongdu Monster in a best of one. They had come into that tournament already having lost to G2, and then the Misfits disappointment a few days ago, and now Unicorns, well, there's something to build on.
And Unicorns showed us two things here. They showed us, first of all, the style that IEM gave us in game one, where it was more about win the lane and try and push through. Well, game two was more about picking lane matchups that you're comfortable with and then playing it out in their own style. The Cassio, the Gangplank, not good in the laning phase specifically that early on, but utilizing
sign for the Unicorns as we head closer and closer into playoffs. Chachi, you know, kind of had a banner play, of course, for himself on the Gangplank, but different types of Unicorns, different players can step up on a different time, a different day. So it was nice to see overall that they showed different types of dominance in their series.
Different types of dominance, Unicorns. I think that they are contending right now for that third, fourth spot, which considering they were undefeated for the first, you know, 5 weeks, was not where they'd want to be.
But other teams are stepping up, too. I mean, you look at Misfits that they were able to take them down in the 2-1. I think it's nice to see, like, teams starting to kind of climb back up, especially after IEM. Some teams had a break. Some teams went over there and made some big plays as well. So it kind of shakes things up a bit in the European LCS.
I mean, one thing's for certain. Unicorns aren't missing playoffs again. Like, they make playoffs every split, but they're certainly not missing it now. They're in a comfortable spot. Now it's the game of put yourself in the best position, get that better, you know, playoff match. It's realistically, if you're in third, fourth, you're battling between who are we going to end up playing against. Is it going to be Fnatic from the other group? Yeah. Is that what we want? Will Fnatic somehow
be able
to jump?
You don't know exactly who you're going to be up against, and you want to try to fight for the seeding that you want. But obviously, higher is always better, right?
Yeah, of course, of course. And the way the groups play out, it's actually only Fnatic they would end up playing. I was thinking, will it be Fnatic or Splice? And then realized we're in two groups. So and two plays three from the other group. So looking forward to that playoff setups. When we're later there, we're not quite there though.
No,
we've still got weeks of group play. We got to do another round robin in the groups first.
That's very true, and it's kind of crazy to think like how different a lot of those teams were when you go back to the first couple of weeks and everyone was kind of playing and winning as expected for the most part. Maybe a couple of teams didn't quite live up to the hype, and you know, overall we didn't really have a lot of upsets. I think that might change a little bit this time around.
I think so. Misfits G2, that's going to be a good series.
That's gonna be a great
H2K one. Unicorns, that's going to be a great series. So much still to come in the next couple of weeks.
Definitely as much still to come. But for what's here to come here now, Unicorns, their big win. Quickshot standing by on stage with a very happy nerd.
Well, I tell you what, Mr. Stressed Pirate, I'm not standing by on stage. I'm joined here by the Love Hurts crew as well as Samux and Hillisung. What do you guys have to say for your winning team?
Such a great game. I loved it.
Fantastic. Great game here from the fans. Samux, first of all, thank you for joining me. Let's talk a little bit about how the series was for you. It looked pretty simple. It looked pretty easy. How was it for you?
Well, for me, my job was just to push waves, obviously. Then my team is going to work. Then I am the CC bot, obviously, because I'm the AD carry. So I had to play Jhin, and it went well for me, I guess.
Well, CC bot worked out in your favor. Hilly, it's been a rough couple of weeks. It wasn't as confident wins for the last three. What's been happening, you know, from IEM and from the last week of LCS?
Maybe we lost some confidence in our players and in general in our team. But maybe this is only for me, because we lost against G2 and then we went to IM and it was a bit failure. But other than that, we are learning and we are fixing mistakes fast, and I hope we can show that in next weeks, and yeah, we're getting there.
Definitely getting there. Hilly, you're one of the longtime members of the UOL squad. You've got this loud, crazy bunch behind us every single week cheering. Is the scary unicorns man here this week?
No, he isn't.
Where is he?
Do we know where he is?
You know what? It's fine. It was.
It's his dad's birthday, so I think that's an excuse.
Okay. What's it like having this amount of support and, you know, Mr. Unicorns every week, Hilly?
It feels great, like when you make a play in game and you hear the crowd shouting and being happy that we're winning. It gives us like a lot of confidence in game, and I guess enemy is like a bit like, oh my god, what is happening, you know? And it helps us a lot, and it's great feeling.
Well, it's a great feeling. It's obviously great for a shoutcaster. We get very excited. Samux, what's it like coming into the team? You know, this fan crew was this loud, sometimes annoying, for a while, and you're one of the new guys. So how was that support for you?
To be honest, I didn't really expect that when I came to the team, but I think it's really awesome. It's really awesome because we get really excited when we hear the crowd and we get really confident.
Yeah, it obviously must help out. Let's talk about IEM from your perspective. Tough tournament, obviously, and there was some struggles. So what did you take away from Intel Extreme Masters?
So I think even though we lost, I think we learned a lot because we scream flash walls a lot and they are really insane in macro level. So definitely we learned a lot from screams and from flash walls in the IEM.
All right, learned a lot. We'll see if it helps out. It didn't necessarily work against Misfits. Just to give you guys an update, waiting for Sheepy to join on the analyst desk. So before we get there, Hillisang, let's look forward, all right? Losing to Misfits. I made a statement that maybe Misfits or H2K are the second best team in Europe. Taking you off, what do you think about that?
I think we're the second best team, but we have to fix some little issues in communication in-game to be there. But for now, maybe H2K and Misfits are a bit better, but I think we have more potential.
Well, more potential, we'll have to see. Hillisang, let's look towards playoffs. Where do you think the Unicorns will finish?
I think, I'm not sure, but if we work like we're doing right now and not like the last week, I think we can be really high.
All right, really high. One last question to Samux. Where would you like to finish at the end of the spring split? And what is considered successful for you?
I don't want to really set high expectations because this is my first split as AD carry, so I just want to do my best and let's see where we are.
All right, thank you so much. I want to thank Samux, thank Hillisang for joining us. Congratulations on the win, and Unicorns!
Unicorns!
Over to you guys.
Thank you very much to the Love Hurts crew, to both Unicorns Love Member and Quickshot as well. Welcome to the post-game lobby, where Deficio is joined now by Hussein Mousvi and Coach Fabian Sheepy Milan. So we got two coaches, we got Deficios.
Yeah. Almost the same.
It's almost the same. You're almost. Like a coach.
Yeah.
Whatever you say. All right. Well, we're going to focus up. Sheepy, I want to go to you first. Coming out 2-0 in the end, how did you feel about that series?
I think we played pretty well. I think we didn't take too many risks. We played the game relatively normal. We pushed out lanes. I think we didn't go for so many flashy plays as people might have expected, but I think we just cleanly won the games.
Disappointed in the lack of flashy plays. Only Hillisang brought
some. You're so inconsistent. Did it win and it's flashy plays?
Jeep, it's never good enough. No, it's pretty good.
All right. Well, let's take a chance now to look back on the week. Of course, the series to start us all off was Misfits versus the Unicorns of Love. And I want to take a look back on that now. Misfits coming out on top in the end. Sheepy, we haven't heard as much from you about this series. I kind of wanted to get your thoughts overall.
I think in this series, our early game was not that great, to say it like this. We're not so prepared for the early game dives on the top side, and they were able to snowball relatively good in those games. And then afterwards it was harder to play the map, but I still think that we played a better, stronger mid and late game. And I think that we could have won the series as well on another day. But yeah, props to Misfits in the end winning out the game.
I agree with that. I think especially game three, it came down, it was very close, and it really did come down to like the closest dragon fight, and you know, even at the end of the fight, it was a 50-50 Baron. So I think the series overall was close. I think both teams are probably even right now. Maybe we're better in the early game, they're better in mid game, but going into playoffs, I think both teams will probably fix their issues.
I think very fair to say. Let's take a chance now to look at another series we saw in the week, G2 versus Vitality coming in. Now, interesting to see G2 come back into this one.
Almost as close as Unicorns and Misfits. Oh, not quite, not quite.
So I kind of wanted to get your guys' impressions of G2 as a team as we look at this one. Vitality maybe on the up and up a little bit, but not really vying for playoffs at this point. How did you guys feel about G2 watching this series? And do you feel like they're getting stronger, weaker? What's your impression overall?
I think it's a little difficult to say if they're stronger or weaker because they looked okay at IEM. They made it to the finals to beat both Korean teams, but still you see those issues in G2 that you saw during the regular season as well. And Vitality is one of those teams that can't really punish that. So I think we'll have to see G2 against a better team to see if they're actually better from IEM. But they look good so far.
Yeah, they did their job. You know, that's kind of that kind of thing right now, you know, when you have top four with bottom four, like same you guys today against Origin, you guys against Rocket. It's like you get a 2-0. You play like pretty well for most of it, and then you just did your job. You know, you kind of move on and you start focusing on the next series. I think it's the same for G2 here. So yeah, it's really hard to judge, you know, when the top teams are playing the bottom teams, if the top teams are like playing super well at the moment or if it's just a really weak opponent.
But I'm actually happy to see that this is actually the outcome from it, because I think that there were times where, especially for us, we weren't sure going into the game if we actually like stronger, because a lot relied on to how strong we felt in the meta and how the champions were and how our early game shaped up. And it could have like swung either way. And I think right now it's like maybe a bit clearer. Like you actually can see that they are making most of the times better decisions than the lower tier teams. And I think this is kind of nice to see as a trend, because now you can actually, for you, your job is a bit easier. You can go with a prediction and then and say, you know, it should actually be like this.
It's kind of opposite of what we used to have in Europe, where top teams would lose to bottom teams all the time. We never really knew, you know, who was consistent.
But it made it
or not.
So exciting.
But it made it very exciting. And now we always just looking forward to these big games between the top teams, because they are just performing much better than the rest.
All right. Well, let's take a chance now to look at the standings and how they unfolded at the end of week six. Groups A and B, two that we're going to have to look at here. G2 Esports, once again, on the top, undefeated. Misfits, close second, but of course, different group. Guys, is there anything that really stood out to you here this week, or is it as expected, utterly and completely?
I think expected. Honestly, there wasn't really any upsets right now. I think I'm still looking at like next week with Origin Rocket, Origin Giants, like then these fights down the bottom to see who can actually step out of this relegation zone.
Well, it's good that you mention it. Let's take a chance then to look at next week's schedule. We can talk a little bit more about those games. Maybe something that we're not going to see quite as expected. Now, coming up, Unicorns of Love, you guys are going to play Fnatic. Thoughts on that series, Sheepy? How do you feel about coming up against Fnatic so far?
Well, I think they got a lot of flag for the draft. And I feel drafting right now in Europe especially is like really, really important to come in with a good idea. I mean, especially when the first time we played against G2 and they really targeted like strategies from us, it like really shut us down in a way. And I think that against Fnatic, this will be a really big point. And just play-wise, I think that we have a really strong or solid mid-game right now. So I would expect us to come out stronger, but you never know. So yeah, I think for Fnatic, also with their changes, maybe not as strong as before, or like at least as they should be at this point in the split.
I think a bit of a common sentiment at this point. See how Fnatic adapts, maybe they'll bring something new to the table. But of course, Hussein, you guys now going up against H2K, another team in the top four, the upper echelon, top versus top battle. What do you think is going to be the big determining factor in that series?
I think the interesting about us and H2K is that we're very similar teams. We both have really good early games. We still have work to do in mid game. And then both teams focus very much on pushing waves, looking for vision, and maybe playing a little slower than other teams might, but really pushing for the best back row play. And it's honestly going to come down to whichever team does it best on that day. And I'm so excited for that match.
I just want Origin Rocket, man. Someone has to win down at the bottom.
All right, Fischio. I'll take that as positive attitude, I think.
Yeah, super positive. I'm actually really looking forward to that series.
All right. Do you get to cast it?
I do get to cast it with Quickshot. So
self-advertisement.
Just the only
there
the
you
best.
Go, guys. Tune in on Thursday for that cast and the game.
Well, if you're joining us in the client, be sure to hit up youtube.com/lolesports for the extended version of the post-game lobby. We're talking about a lot of different things tonight, something you won't want to miss. All right. We've done our official pause. We can now talk about whatever we want to. But first, we asked Twitter. We asked them to participate. We wanted to hear about favorite champions, favorite combos coming out. And I think pretty much all of Twitter was united. We're going to pull one tweet from Wes in particular who said, the Mega Hextech Inferno Ultimatum Bomb from the Splice bot lane. Okay, so.
Camille Ziggs.
Camille Ziggs, for context here, gentlemen. Now, I want your opinions on Camille Ziggs as a combo. We heard some like kind of jokey commentary coming in, some kind of serious. Is this viable and competitive?
I think it is viable.
Yeah.
If it's really strong, it's a different question. It's definitely viable.
I think it has a place, and the strength is more so probably in draft than like within the 2v2 itself. And more so, it opens up so many different possibilities for mid and top lane or for jungle. So I actually think that it's a very exciting duo down there.
Yeah. Just imagine you can flex those into mid lane and into top lane and maybe other roles as well. Yeah.
Camille jungle, mid lane too. AD carry. Where can Camille go?
Yeah, this can go everywhere. But I think before the nerfs, this was actually like more legitimate and you had like more burst potential and longer stun duration with Camille support. Now it's kind of fizzled out and I think it's like okay, but not something that's insane.
Why did it take Europe like 4 to 5 weeks to start using Ziggs bot lane when from week one in LCK it was actually used already? Was it just because of Camille? Because I'm pretty sure we saw it in other situations as well, like after a few weeks. It just took quite a while.
Mm. I think that Ziggs overall bottom lane is strong because you can push the wave and you can contest if against certain ADCs you are like really, really strong, especially short range because they need to walk up. So I think it has its place. Also, from the research we did that, for example, Flash Wolves banned out every ADC and then just picked Ziggs and then they had like a really strong bot lane. I mean, this is also an idea. Mm-hmm. But I think just overall in Europe, we have like different strengths and different strategies we go for. So the Ziggs bot lane is not really like the kicker in all the pick and ban phases.
I think in our case, like early on, of course, we played against Ziggs and scrims and stuff, but teams have improved a lot in Europe since the LCS started to now. And I think that means that you can see the strength of Ziggs more, especially in practice, where before, because teams weren't making the best decisions, maybe the strength of Ziggs wasn't showing up so much here, where LCK is obviously a much stronger region there.
Oh, and I also think that Ziggs fitting in a team comp is way harder than, for example, like a Varus or an Ashe or Jhin, because usually you get like this kind of engage a bit from bot lane. Mm-hmm. And with Ziggs, it's kind of the follow-up. Like you want to, I don't know, Camille goes in, ultimates like a target, and you just Ziggs ultimate on top of it. So yeah, I think that for us, it's more important to have like those other picks like Ashe and Jhin.
Yeah. Good to see kind of how that will develop. Excited to hear that now the teams may know how to execute it more. I personally am a fan of the Ziggs AD carry, even if many of the other analysts think that it's a little limited. I think it would be the polite way to rephrase Krepo on that one. He hates it. I know he hates it. There's one thing that I really want to talk about, though. So I feel like so often recently when we judge a team and how well a top team is playing in Europe and internationally as well, we always talk about the perfect game. You know, the ideal macro game, the kill list, the bloodless game. And I want to kind of get your guys' opinion on the perfect game as a concept. Is this something that we should all be working towards? What is the place of the perfect game when we look for top teams to improve? Is this the shining gold standard, or should you look to do something different?
It's always tough because I don't think there's ever been a perfect game by like anyone. We're not talking about the whole we don't give them any kills and towers and then we win the game, but more like every decision was just like the correct one. Because I feel like very often in League of Legends, decisions come down to like percentages, basically. It's like, if we dive top here, that's like an 80%, you know, play for us. So there's a high chance we can execute it. But there's another play, which is a 70% play. So it's hard to say, like, is there always this is the correct one, this is the wrong one? Or is there often just multiple options? And it's just like a little bit different in terms of numbers, which one you pick. And certain teams might value one and the other team might value another one. So I think it's in that case, it's hard to kind of all agree on what is the perfect game and if it is a perfect game, but I don't think it's ever happened that like team just like did everything perfectly, even though I guess it's good to have it as a goal.
Yeah. I think what it comes down to is if you're coaching a team, obviously it's different. You're looking for the perfect game in the sense that you're examining every single decision that's made and seeing if it's the best decision that could be made, what are the chances of it working out, if there's something else we can do. So that's different. But when you're viewing a game, when you're studying the game, then there's different types of mistakes. There's mistakes where someone's just overextended and caught out. There's mistakes where someone forces an overextension or the vision just demands you to make a mistake. And those are the kind of mistakes that you can appreciate from the side of a team. I think Europe does a pretty good job of that right now, actually, with vision. They've stepped up quite a bit.
curious. I think for a perfect game, that's, if you have two different teams executing something totally different, like 1-3-1 compared to 1-4, or any kind of combo play or any kind of, I don't know, poke compositions. There's like different kind of 1-3-1 with double TP as well, which we'd like to play before in the split. I think if you have this clash of styles, I think that it's very, very hard to judge what is like the perfect game. Obviously, you should pursue to have the best decisions in every position. But it's like very hard to determine what is actually perfect. So you just kind of like curve out close to it and just say like, this is a better decision than the one before. Mm-hmm. Then you apply it, and next time you know if it's actually better. And especially in the development right now, it's like in every game, like Counter-Strike, chess, you know, like even this kind of stuff, is that I think our knowledge right now from League of Legends is already way more improved than, you know, if you look back even like 2 months or three. Mm-hmm. So it's actually really interesting to see that right now, whatever we perceive as like perfect game, or like even if we struggle towards it, might actually be extremely far away from the most positive thing that can happen. So I think it's something that we will not ever achieve, but we should definitely pursue it.
I just like to also look at like the plays being made, and then kind of say in terms of risk and reward. So like there's a low risk, medium risk, high risk, and then of course low, medium, and high reward. And I feel like if you follow all the steps, oftentimes, like if you always set up the vision first, if you then know the cooldowns on things like teleport and flash, if you understand the power spikes of your champions, you keep ticking some boxes that makes your play, whatever play it is you're about to do, like low and lower risk. But at the same time, the reward might stay really, really high because you can now see everyone, so you go for that tower dive. It gives you 2 kills and a tower. And as long as you execute a fairly simple dive, you get, you know, the big reward. And ideally, a team always looks for the low, maybe medium risk and high reward plays. But there is no game where you only have those kind of situations. And the enemy team is obviously trying to do exactly the same. So it gets really, really difficult. But I like to seeing a lot of teams with these low risk plays that gives like a very clear reward. And you can see how they were setting up to make it a lower risk. Because diving without vision is very high risk. Place the deep wards first, boom, might become a low risk play all of a sudden. And I like seeing those kind of things. And that's kind of how I can look at it. Great or perfect game in a sense, even though technically it never is just perfect everything.
I feel like for us it's really easy to identify low slash high risk plays when they're single picks around vision. I think the issue for me as a viewer that I always struggle with is team fighting. Like how do you tell when a team is taking a good team fight versus a bad team fight when it's like a full-on 5v5, there's no clear like item advantage? Because so often when I see games like that, I think people are quick to label it like clown fiesta, why are they fighting, what are they doing? Like how can you call how can you tell like a clean play when it comes to team fighting? Compared to like a poor play or a poor decision there? Is it just in the results of the play, or are you able to discern kind of ahead of time whether or not this is a good choice to go into these kind of fights?
I think it's extremely subjective. And even if you have expert or like so-called experts in this field and they say like this is exactly what they should have done and this would have turned out perfectly, they might have missing out like a lot of stuff. And I think for the viewer it's especially difficult because we're doing a lot of stuff and like a level that they cannot perceive, like how we're exactly pushing out stuff and what we're keeping track of. Like it's our job to do this, like they have Shen ulti and TP, and if they do this, what do we do then? And how do we exactly push out and do we wait? And it's like a lot to get into, but especially for team fighting, you should always ask yourself, what do they try to achieve here? And are they achieving, is it necessary? Absolutely. So Clan Fiesta is basically both sides are fighting for nothing. Mm-hmm. And then they just chase each other and you don't have like a real goal. And if whoever wins, the outcome is really, really low. And the better teams are always setting the stakes higher. Like if you're losing here the team fight and all your lanes are pushed, you're going to lose 2 inhibitors. And like lower end teams will have team fights just to get kills. And then it's really, really easy to get the team fight because you just can kite back. You have no pressure on yourself. So I think this is like the most important thing. How much pressure is on each side for this team fight? Mm-hmm. For what are they fighting? And did they achieve what they wanted to do in this team fight? And then I think it's really interesting for the viewer because it's not so clear. So you can have actually this argument with your friend where you say, man, this was so great and this was so bad. We have exactly the same in the gaming house where people say, oh, this was not great. But, you know, this is how you... That's so interesting about it. You develop with the game.
I think visually you can also tell if, like, it's a good team fight or not, because if two good teams are team fighting, the team fighting... And either to deny vision or to gain vision somewhere. So that immediately tells you that it's for an objective. And that's a good team fight. Other teams might team fight just because they see someone and skill hero, see hero, and that's about it. So, like, just visually, you can tell by seeing where the wards on the map are and where mm-hmm. they're fighting, and that should tell you whether it's like a clown fiesta or if it's like a mismanagement of team fight or like anything like that.
I think we saw that really explained or showcased like SKT, KT, obviously two best teams in the world when they fight. You know, a lot of it wasn't actually necessarily like fighting over like a specific tower or something. It was more like, we want to set a vision in your jungle so we can make these plays in a minute. So the enemy team is like, no, you're not going to put your wards here. We're not going to fight you over these wards. And like, they would fight over vision. Whoever would gain control would then be able to kind of control the pace of the game for a few more minutes. And it was like KT trying to push it early and SKT trying to defend late. And it was just a really cool way to see also the way they're fighting, where sometimes, you know, in Europe, you see teams just kind of clash into each other. Everyone just kind of dies pretty quickly, and then
the
fight is over.
Disappears.
Yeah, the dust like disappears. There's like one guy being like, hey, I'm alive, you know, I can't do anything. But when you watch like the SKT, KT series again, it's like a lot of like in and out. People like stepping in, you do a little bit, then you back out again. People don't really die instantly, and they kind of like keep like having this standoff against each other, which just shows like, it shows like really good understanding of, you know, how to fight and the limitation of your character. But as a viewer and as a caster, you know, we do get a little bit spoiled when we watch like KT and SKT, because they are like the two best teams. Yeah. No one else in the world will play series like they do against each other. So it's, in that sense, it's a shame, because you watch it and then you go and be like, okay, now I have to watch every other team in the world and I don't feel like I'm getting the same level. But that's just something as a viewer and as a caster, you know, as a coach even, like, we just have to accept that mistakes will happen in games. It doesn't make it a clown fiesta. As long as there's a game plan, you know, as long as the teams are somewhat executing what they're supposed to do, it can still be at a very high level, just not necessarily the one where you go and win the world final against SKT and KT. But that's not the goal for these teams just yet. You know, getting there first and improving along the way is the key thing.
Yeah, so kind of the stakes in the fight, seeing what you really stand to gain when we look at a fight, is kind of the determining factor between clean or maybe good games. I don't want to say clean games and mm-hmm. clown fiesta. Good to have that insight. However, a league that is no stranger to stakes and no stranger to clean games either. We're getting close to the end of the summer split the spring split for the European Challenger Series. So let's send it over to Stress, who can break that one down for us.
Thank you very much, Dracos. Yes, let's get you all up to speed with what happened last week on the European Challenger Series. Well, last week we had the Battle of the Academies, Misfits Academy versus Fnatic Academy, and we were hoping one team would graduate, perhaps bringing in an older student and amazing from Fnatic. They could have copied his homework and maybe got themselves a great grade. Well, it looked good in the first assignment of the split, because Kigis in the top lane got so far ahead on this Jace, just split pushed everything. He got himself the bottom inhibitor tower, two Nexus Towers. Didn't even matter that his team were losing a Baron, because it was enough for Fnatic Academy to close out the first game. Clean win, strong win, and the strongest we've seen them since week one. Game two, however, not so great. They picked up Rengar for amazing, and it looked so good at the beginning of the game, but it got dragged out, stalled out on the game by Misfits Academy. And Mr. Rales, who was playing on Sivir, managed to get to that late game point, but had nobody around them to peel for him, and ended up being a 1-1 series. So unfortunately, there was no 2-0 victor to try and separate themselves from the pack in series one. But series two brought us Paris Saint-Germain's first 2-0 win of the split as well. This was against Kinguin and White Knight, a very old school player here in Europe, reaffirmed himself. And what better way to do it within this amazing top lane Gragas dive, level 6. Ice Bisto had no chance to get away from that. And honestly, PSG looked like a different team. They looked dominant, shut out Kinguin 2-0, and are making a late split run for a playoff spot. Speaking of playoff spots, Schalke 04, they don't only have a playoff spot, they're locked rank 1. They're going into the playoffs as seed number 1, as they are undefeated, and game 1 was a repeat of everything Schalke have showed us until this point. Selfie on the Kassadin alongside Lulex on Ivan, just snowballing the game so beautifully, and Schalke would continue to work as a unit better than any other team in Challenger do right now. But game two, there was actually a game plan coming out from Millennium. Selfie got camped, ended the laning phase on the Kassadin at 0-4, and we thought maybe Millennium had what it would take to take down Schalke, put a blemish on the record heading into the playoffs, but it wasn't enough. It looked like Millennium had the win, and they would be pushing up to the inhibitor, looking to close out what would be a monumental upset, and they overstep At the end of this game, Selfie had 9 kills from a 0-4 laning phase on this Kassadin. They turn everything around, and the history books show another 2-0 win for Schalke. It wasn't as clean as it's been before, but they are still undefeated. And this week, with their safe spot at 12 points, there's a lot going on for the rest of the teams here. 5 teams can still make it into playoffs. 5 teams could potentially tie for those playoff spots. And Schalke, we know, will be set at the top of the table. We'll be bringing you Challenger action tomorrow at 3 p.m. Central European time. Keep an eye on it. There are so many huge implications for the EU-LCS. But for now, let's get back to PGL. There was some interesting discussion about, perfect games and team fights. I'm loving it.
Thank you very much, Stress. Of course, I kind of want to touch on Challenger, interestingly enough, as we continue the story. Now, Hussein, you guys aren't too far removed from the Challenger Series, despite how fantastic you're doing in LCS. I kind of wanted to ask you, how does playing, at the comfort of your home during the Challenger Series compare to kind of playing on the stage here in the LCS?
I think, when we were in Challenger, our goal was not just to make LCS. Like, from day one, we said, look, it doesn't matter if you just make LCS if you're not good enough. So we're going to build on the basics, we're going to build on the fundamentals, and then, go from there. So when we're in LCS, we're ready to actually play on the big stage. And overall, I think that helped quite a bit in our development. We didn't have to develop that during an LCS split, and that was, a big factor. I think that's what, the best thing about Challenger is.
I feel like you guys last split were a little bit like Schalke is now, where you're kind of dominating the Challenger scene. People have very high expectations. Everyone is already saying, coming into promotion tournament, that Schalke will just qualify to the LCS. Yet we so often see that the dominating Challenger team, when they sit on stage in promotion tournament against the weakest LCS team, they're not always that dominant, and it's kind of shaky. You guys even lost, obviously, to Origin. Does it change a lot when you then sit down on that stage for the first time? Or is it just because Challenger teams maybe aren't as good as they do look in the Challenger scene?
I think it depends on, how many rookies you have and what their personality is like. In our case, we had 2 rookies, I believe, at the time. And then we had Selfie, who hadn't been in LCS for a while. So, of course, on stage, we're going to play differently to Talent Challenger, and I think we did. But we also fixed it very quickly for the Schalke series. So it honestly just depends on the team and what the coaching staff is like and how confident the players themselves are.
Did you have anything, Shibi?
You said that you're always preparing as if you want to compete in the LCS. What exactly does that mean? And I understand the mindset, but what does it actually mean? Because I would like to, start thinking now, okay.
Prepare for Challenger.
I'm going to win Worlds, which is true, and we should have this kind of mindset, but there needs to be something following the mindset, right?
Well, so in our case, we had 5 really strong individual players, but especially if you watch the first game that we played in Challenger, it was very messy, people were throwing, and you really relied on the fact that these players were individually better than their counterparts, and so maybe they weren't making the best decisions in early game and mid game, whatever it may be, but they were getting away with it. And so the focus in Challenger was, well, let's kind of shadow box against an LCS team when we scrim. If we made this decision against better individual players, would this work out for us? If not, what's the best decision?
But wouldn't you do that anyway? It's not like if my mindset is, okay, I just want to participate in LCS or in Challenger Series, you would still try to improve that way, no?
Not necessarily. I know there are teams that, even in LCS right now, if they're not performing as well as a top 4 team, for example, their goal is different. A bottom 4 team in LCS right now is looking to not get into relegation. They might look at playing comfort champions more. They might look at just playing what's easy for them to execute on versus what's the best, game plan. As an example, Malzahar is very highly rated in Europe right now, where in the rest of the world it's not so high rated, and that's because there are teams that just overextend too much and get caught out.
Do you think they are aware that it's suboptimal decisions that they are going for?
The Challenger teams or?
No, the bottom LCS teams, like you say, for example, Malzahar is a strong pick and so on.
I'm not sure, actually. Maybe they're... I think, for example, Malzahar is something that bottom 8-4 teams should pick more often. It's an easier champion to execute on, it's easy to punish someone else, a better player on if he makes a tiny mistake, where if a bottom 4 team tries to execute on something like MF or Zyra support, it's a much different game altogether, right? And I think that was sort of our mindset in Challenger too. Well, we can take the easier route where it's very easy to beat these teams if you just pick these 2-3 champions that we're comfortable and just keep snowballing on them. But if we make it more difficult for ourselves, if we actually look to make better decisions instead of the easy decision, then what does that play out like?
Right. It's the whole thing we see, the big debate, about from other people as well, outside of just, us sitting right here, between early game snowball and like mid to late game focus and so on. And I mean, I think it makes a lot of sense that if you can stomp people in the early game because you have better lanes, there's better individual players, you know, it's a very easy way to kind of pick up some wins. You might lose one game here and there, but you should pick up enough wins to move on. And then you kind of have to learn the rest after, which can be a problem. And I definitely also, like, I 100% agree with the Malzahar pick. Like, we were talking about this during the game when you guys were playing, where, like, Rocket had chances to, like, take a Malzahar and play, like, Malzahar Ashe bot lane or something with a Shen top. And you'd be like, okay, double CC bot lane, you know, strong level 6, Shen ulti. That's, it shows, like, a very clear game plan. You can tell your team as a coach, you know, going in, guys, get level 6, use it, try to use it to, like, snowball the bottom side. And they opted, you know, to give you the Malzahar instead that Hillisang was using to create a lot of picks around the map. And it's one of these situations where, you know, maybe, I'm not saying that's the only reason, you know, Rocket is a bottom team, but I definitely agree that there are picks that can help them create or give themselves, like, easier ways to maybe get some early kills and use it to try and get an advantage when they don't have a whole lot going on for them.
Well, it's interesting you bring up the bottom teams. I actually kind of want to turn to the top teams quickly, because something you said really stood out to me, and that's that playing like you're playing against a better team or an LCS team or trying to find those windows, and that's kind of what we've heard has been the strategy from G2, right? They're not playing to be better players. They're not playing to find lane advantages or opportunities that are given to them. They're playing for better back timings and playing for better strategies, which sounds a lot like what you guys are doing or were doing in the Challenger scene. And my question is, at what point are you kind of holding back the development of your team, or at what point do you need to go, we're not going to be that team, we're going to be the team that wins early game, that wins on individual laning strength, and when is that kind of acceptable?
I think in Challenger, we knew that our early game would just be good enough just because we had the players for it. So we had the luxury to work on our mid game, and we did. And then we got into LCS, and you saw our early games were still good the first 2 weeks, and our mid game was difficult. So that's the area we need to work on. Then as we started improving on that, our early game started slowing down in LCS. So then we were like, okay, we need to mix it up a bit. We still have growth in mid game to do, but our early game has to be on point. So then we looked at jungle routes and different invade strategies and stuff. So I think, at least in our case, definitely focus more on mid game than early game, but it's still a bit of a mix. It depends on like what strategy is available and such.
And I'm curious, Sheepy, do you think there's any room kind of in the competitive landscape for there to be a team that is just like solely focused on winning out in the early game and trying to snowball from there? I feel like it's been a long time since we've seen a team that can get giant gold leads and just close out games very quickly. I feel like every team now has to learn the mid game and the late game as well. Is there any room left kind of in the competitive landscape for there to be a team that is just gods of the early game, outplays their opponents on an individual level?
I kind of followed the discussion from, I think, G2 coach or, I don't know, mental
coach. Yeah.
Weldon. And there was like a lot of uproar between like early and mid game. And it was like 2 hours, 41 minutes discussions. I'm really shrugging my head because it's like, it's not that difficult. I mean, your pursuit is really, you want to be the strongest team. And whatever means you find for that, you're going to improve on it. And whatever you see you can improve on, you should just like keep working on it. So, and you do that every day. And it doesn't matter if it's like early game or mid game. Obviously, the point is that if you're together as five people and you want to kind of go over the replay, then you do the only stuff that you can do as five people, which is like you go over actions that you have to do as a team, because that just makes most sense to practice when we're together. Then if I just talk with one person and four people are not using their mind, well, I will do that sometimes, you know, if it's like very important matchup and people should know what's going on there. But I think everyone is just missing the point. Like it's you just want to get better as much as you can. You improve on your mistakes, you try to learn as much as possible every day and so on. And obviously you will try to do the more team focused stuff because it's just the most efficient. And everyone who doesn't do it is just missing knowledge, because I don't believe that the mindset, I think mindset is something the coach should like enhance and like try to show the way so that people are always giving like 100%. Obviously that's hard to give that, but that, the mindset is like one thing, but I think that they are just missing how exactly to improve as a team. And that's where like experience is in. And I think, I mean, I have a bit of experience in coaching in this. And this is what I feel like. In the beginning, I just didn't know what to coach. And now I slowly understand what's actually important and like how to get in the right direction. And I think that's the most important thing for a Challenger Series team, that they just don't exactly know how to do it. And that's why it fails, and not so much for any other reason.
Yeah, overall, the big discussion seems to mainly be about, like, you don't have all the time in the world, so what do you focus on the most? And obviously, Shibis is like the number one goal is to focus on just improving. But then people can say we spend X amount of hours on this or X amount of hours on that one. Obviously, difference between teams. I don't know certain things, how much you can practice it in like your own region. Because I think like G2's mid game, which is the big discussion, or mid to late game, showed a lot of weaknesses at IEM against like Flash Wolves and even some of the Korean teams. And you'd be like, do they get enough practice in Europe then in terms of mid game? Do teams punish enough? That's some of the big questions and why a lot of teams internationally struggle when they didn't get to face like the Korean teams who are like really, really good mid to late game, understand vision, pressure, jungle, all that kind of stuff, you know? So that's why it's really difficult to say we just practice like mid to late game, because you might not get in good enough practice in your own region to then use it against the top, top teams in the world. But maybe you don't need to beat them and, you know, it's enough to win in Europe. I'm not sure, but it is difficult.
Well, let's focus in on Europe. We do, of course, have a very exciting schedule coming up next week. It is our final group of cross-week play here in the EU LCS, and here's what we've got to look forward to. We saw it earlier. We talked to you guys a little bit about your matchups. Aside from your own teams, what is the matchup you're most looking forward to? Deficio, stop saying Rocket versus Origin. Let's get the guests in.
Come on, Rocket.
Rocket. Splice. No, Vitality. I think that's G2 Splice is like the other one that's really big. I don't know exactly how Splice is doing against G2, because I think G2 is just like overall a little bit stronger. Mm-hmm. But I do think that there's like possibilities for like kind of an upset, or like at least Splice showing a lot of strength.
Do any of you guys scrim Splice a lot or anything? Like, have you noticed like progression from them? Because they started so slow, we expected so much.
We don't scrim so much against Splice.
Okay.
We scrimmed a fair bit. I think they've improved quite a bit from where they were at the start of the week. I mean, they've always had the coaching staff to do so. They've always had that was the big thing about Splice last year. So it would be weird if they didn't improve. I don't know if they'll improve fast enough, because I think G2, us, Unicorns, we all have good staffs at this point, and we all know how to improve as a team. But they've definitely improved enough where I think they can maybe take a game or two.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. It's time for us to log out of the client here at the EU LCS. Thanks to Sheepy, Hussein. I guess I can thank Deficio too. We'll see you.
I was just here.
Yeah. We'll see you next Thursday at 5 p.m. Central European time for another big week of the ULCS goodness. That's 4 days, ladies and gentlemen. Until then, have a great week. Good night. And we'll see you later, esports friends.
Becca, you want to psych them out and stay on mid lane?
Yeah, I will stay here for a couple of minutes.
No, don't die to Raptors! Taste the fear. Defensive leap with the Krugs helping out, a Kakao gets first blood.
Man.
Expect it decides to engage, puts down the Glacial Fissure. Good damage, teleport follow through for Sartorius. Pekka tabs in the 2v2.
Chase.
They're following their leader. Expect is leading the way. One more hit for the stun. Ignore goes down.
He's going to be able to find some support.
Flash over as Alfari wants to try clean up. Negan's running for his life. The riposte will not find a stun. A lunge forward as the challenge is completed. Two members of Misfits kill for three of Origin. Kakao looking to set up. Sonic Wave. Not going to need it just yet as Kakao's tanking the turret. They're trading aggro back and forth. Dashing out.
Nice. Big bot there.
So scary. The Equalizer gets everybody. Baron's picked up by Origin, but at what cost? Misfits are looking to kill the Nexus, not before they tag up Xpeke. And with 14 losses, Origin break the longest losing streak in EU LCS history.
The Baron might be up for grabs after all. A double kill for Faxi. They're sweeping away the Unicorns. The Baron's still on. A triple kill for the Meganar. And there they go. Xerxes secures the Baron, but there's hardly anyone to hold it. Unicorns are cleaning up. It's Betsy taken down to zero. A triple kill for the Djinn. And Yarnen is the only one to live. It's all Nexus. Unicorns. The fans say fear their horns. And Rocket know exactly why. After game one, Unicorns lead the series.
Into jump.
There we go. Jumped on, and it's first blood. Betsy taking tower shots.
No.
He's going to go down, and Exile gets a return kill. Visit Chachi, gun to the head of the AD carry, and Exile just dominates what did, and Betsy finds himself alone without allies. Even Hillisane gets a kill. Exile seemingly moving ahead. He gets one. Can he get more? He gets taunted up, but the rest of his friends have arrived. They jump on to get another kill. Cannon Barrage. Betsy's fired down, and all of a sudden, the Unicorns decide they want to end this right here, right now.